Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Sharmini Peres coming to you from Baltimore. The United Nations says it is resuming the humanitarian aid convoy to Aleppo after its initial attempts were bombed several days ago, which killed at least 20 people. The announcement comes days after the U.S. dropped bombs on the Syrian army, which killed over 60 soldiers. The Syrian government responded by saying it will no longer adhere to the ceasefire negotiated by the U.S. and Russia earlier this month. The U.S. says the attack was a mistake. Meanwhile, Syrian President Bashar al-Assad recently told Associated Press, "I don't believe the United States will be ready to join Russia in fighting terrorists in Syria." Assad also said that peace won't come until Turkey, U.S., Saudi Arabia and Qatar stop supporting terrorism in Syria. And in his final speech to the United Nations, President Barack Obama told the General Assembly that the conflicts throughout the Middle East, including Syria, are the product of an oppressive political elite. This is what he had to say.
There, so much of the collapse in order has been fueled because leaders sought legitimacy not because of policies or programs, but by resorting to persecuting political opposition or demonizing other religious sects, by narrowing the public space to the mosque, where in too many places perversions of a great faith were tolerated. And these forces built up for years and are now at work helping to fuel both Syria's tragic civil war and the mindless medieval menace of ISIL.
Joining us now from Burlington, Vermont, to discuss the geopolitics of Syria is Ashley Smith. Ashley is a researcher for the Center for Economic Research and a member of the International Socialist Review editorial board. His most recent article on Syria is titled, "The Ceasefire That Will Increase War in Syria." Ashley, good to have you with us again.
Thank you for having me.
So let's take up this recent remarks by both Assad and Obama. Assad says the conflict is fueled by external forces, while Obama says the conflict is a result of state repression and sectarianism. Your opinion on who and what is fueling this war in Syria?
Well, let's start first with comments from the dictator Bashar al-Assad. It's a bit rich when you think today the combined forces of Russia and the Syrian regime are bombing relentlessly civilian targets in the city of Aleppo and its liberated areas. And this is part of an ongoing counter-revolution that the Assad regime launched from the very beginning of what was one of the most important popular revolts that occurred back in 2011 as part of the Arab Spring. And Assad's whole strategy since that revolt was to try and defy and conquer the resistance, first by repressing it with the barrel bombs that have obliterated whole sections of Syria, and then by releasing sectarian jihadists, Islamic fundamentalists that he had jailed in his own gulag that he runs in as part of his dictatorship in Syria, to try and create a fifth column within the revolt of sectarian terrorists that would go after the Alawite, Christian, and other religious minority populations, so that then Assad could paint the entire opposition, the entire revolution, as a terrorist one. So that's been Assad's essential strategy, and he's tried to paint the whole situation as a confrontation between his regime and terrorism, when in fact it's been a counter-revolution against one of the most important popular revolts that happened back in 2011. So it's complete hypocrisy, and it deflects the blame from the main culprit of the problem in Syria, which is the regime itself. Now, of course, other international powers have intervened some on the side of the Assad regime, others on the side of various Islamic fundamentalist forces, and they're all poles of the counter-revolution against the popular revolt that happened. Now, and in responding to the Obama administration, it's unbearable hypocrisy from Obama again. When you think about what the U.S. does domestically, right now we're seeing the National Guard deployed in the city of Charlotte to repress the population there that's protesting another horrific example of police, racist police murder of an innocent black man sitting in a car reading a book. And this is a whole string of police murders that we've seen. And that's on top of what's an ongoing elite that is engaged in repression of the population of the United States. So Obama is a hypocrite at home. He's also a hypocrite abroad. When you think about who one of the biggest forces that has wrecked the Middle East is certainly the United States, both directly through its war on Iraq and then indirectly by it itself backing various forces of counter-revolution within the region. And most importantly, one of the most sectarian, fundamentalist, and reactionary states on the planet, Saudi Arabia, which Obama is promising now a giant new arms deal, even as Saudi Arabia carries through a horrible sectarian war on the people of Yemen. So he's a hypocrite on that front. And finally, he's a hypocrite when he's supporting many of the regimes that he's criticizing, like Sisi's regime in Egypt, which is engaged in a horrible campaign of oppression and repression of trade unionists, democratic activists, and anybody that dissents with the regime, and one that embraces Sharia law. So this is a complete hypocrisy, and I think they have little to stand on, including they support the Iraqi state, which is one of the most sectarian Shia fundamentalist states in the region. Final thing I'd say about Obama, it's a bit of a liberal Islamophobic line to say that mosques are somehow at fault for the development of Islamic fundamentalism. I think we have to say that's a liberal form of Islamophobia to equate mosques with Islamic fundamentalism. Islamic fundamentalism is both a creature that the U.S. helped spawn into being through direct support of the Saudi regime, and its blowback from various forms of American intervention in beginning in Afghanistan on through the rest of the Middle East. So really, both Obama and Assad are two poles of counter-revolution, along with many other poles of counter-revolution, from Iran to the Russian state, etc., all who have Syrian blood on their hands and have no moral high ground to be preaching to the remnants of the popular revolt, which are still struggling for a democratic order in Syria.
Now, Ashley, while you know I will be a great critic of Assad and some of what he's doing in his own country, what he said there about Saudi Arabia, the U.S. and Qatar funding terrorism directly or indirectly is a point to be taken. How do you respond to that?
Of course, I think that, but you have to begin with the reality that the vast bulk of the people who've been massacred, the people who've been displaced, have been displaced and massacred by the Assad regime. We're talking about 500,000 people, 11 million people displaced with overall, and 5 million people driven from the country. And most of that are people who were trying to fight for a democratic order. So the beginning point is a condemnation of state terrorism by Assad's regime itself. And then other powers have gotten involved. Saudi Arabia is one, Qatar is another, Turkey is another, who see have their own regional imperial ambitions, as well as Russia and the United States. And all of them, as I said earlier, are counter-revolutionary. And people on the left should oppose all the various forces that are intervening in Syria, because they're all counter-revolutionary, reactionary, and have played nothing but a negative role, and should be standing on the side of what had been a popular democratic revolution against a horrible tyrannical dictatorship that had oppressed and repressed his people and used all sorts of instruments of torture to maintain control over what was a horrible neoliberal state.
Ashley, you argue that it's incorrect to describe the U.S. policy in Syria as a pursuit of regime change, despite repeatedly calls for Assad to go by high-ranking officials such as John Kerry. In that case, what is actually going on in terms of U.S. involvement in Syria?
Well, we have to go back and remember that the Bush administration did have a policy of rolling regime change, that it wanted to begin with its intervention and occupation of Iraq. And it did want to go on to Syria and Iran as the axis of evil, as the horrible Bush administration called the various regimes that were its opponent regimes, even though you could name many of the countries that Bush supported as part of an axis of evil, tyrannical dictatorships. Nevertheless, that was the ambition of the Bush administration, was to take down those regimes and impose client regimes. But as we know, the Bush administration's war and occupation blew up in its face, and the U.S. suffered perhaps its worst defeat since the Vietnam War. And since then, both the second term of the Bush administration and then the Obama administration have been retreating from any policy of regime change for a policy of trying to stabilize the existing state system. And you can see that in how Obama responded to the Arab Spring. He first responded by trying to support the existing regimes, and then when that became untenable in the face of a mass popular uprising throughout the region, he adopted a strategy of orderly transition, in which the idea would be to get rid of the head of state but retain the existing regime with little modification, a kind of facelift to the regime so that it could maintain the state system, because it drew the conclusion that the worst thing that you can do in the Middle East was leave a power vacuum by destabilizing the existing states. And so the policy that has been very forthright and honest, and in many diplomatic documents that you can read from the Obama administration, the policy throughout the Middle East has been to get rid of the dictator and maintain the state with little modifications, incorporation of obedient lackeys that it could integrate into the existing state. And in some cases, support of the existing state structure. And in the case of Syria, his position was that we would want to get rid of Assad. We, being the American Empire, would want to get rid of Assad, but retain the state as it exists. And he's retreated from that even more, especially in the most recent negotiation, the so-called ceasefire, which is actually not a ceasefire. It was a strategy to try and get Assad and Russia on board with an ongoing war on terror against what had been called the Nusra Front and ISIS. So they went so far as even to open collaboration with the Assad regime, and in what can only be called a political Freudian slip, John Kerry went so far as to say that the U.S. would approve the bombing runs of Assad against the Nusra Front and against ISIS. So you can see that the administration has retreated from any policy of regime change to actually regime stabilization, and in some cases getting rid of the head of the regime, but retaining the core of the state to impose stability. And that's even more so in the case of Iran, which the U.S. has no policy of regime change. In fact, the U.S. is trying to reach an accommodation with Iran that you can see with its deal over nuclear weapons, to its collaboration with the Iranian state in the war against ISIS in Iraq. The U.S. main strategy is to stabilize the Middle East, even if that means cutting deals with previous enemies and engaging in common efforts with so-called enemies. That is, there's no permanent friends, no permanent enemies in imperial politics. They're permanent interests. And the U.S. thinks its permanent interest is served by cutting deals right now and stabilizing the system, and certainly not through regime change, which it fears will destabilize the entire order, which is already rocked to its foundations in the Middle East right now.
Right. And recently in mainstream media, and of course analysts are often referring to what's going on in Syria as well as in Ukraine as a resumption of the Cold War between the United States and Russia, particularly when it comes to Syria and Ukraine. In Syria, are they at odds or are they working together? Because of all the proxies and people that they're negotiating on behalf of, the situation is rather confusing.
Yeah, well, I think there are two things to say about that. First, there's no doubt the case that after the defeat the U.S. suffered in Iraq, combined with the economic crisis and the political deadlock in Washington, D.C., the U.S. has suffered a relative decline as an imperial power. And in that circumstance, new imperialist powers have risen and are increasingly challenging the United States for power in regions and internationally, the most obvious being China and the other being Russia, especially regionally in Eastern Europe and in the Middle East, which Russia is increasingly assertive as an imperial power. So you see the development not of a unipolar world order, but what I call an asymmetric multipolar world order, in which the U.S. is still the number one cop on the planet, but there are other cops that are contending for regional and international power. There are many of them regionally and internationally, but the most important is that three-cornered fight between the U.S., Russia, and China. And in any inter-imperial dynamic, you have cooperation and conflict. Famously, Karl Marx said that the capitalists were a band of warring brothers, and I think that makes it very clear. They're brothers in the sense they're all capitalist powers that exploit workers and oppress nations, but they're also contending for power within a world system. So that helps explain the seeming incoherence of American policy towards Russia in this case. In Ukraine and Crimea, the U.S. and Russia are at loggerheads. In Syria, they have been at loggerheads, but Russia has also salvaged the U.S. from mistakes it might have all made in terms of destabilizing the country even more. Think back to when the Assad regime dropped the chemical weapons, as it's been doing in an ongoing way to the people of Syria. And Obama had called that a red line, but Russia quickly stepped in and cut a deal with the Assad regime, and the Obama administration quickly backed down. So there's been a cooperative and confrontational relationship between the U.S. and Russia in Syria, and I think that was very clear in this ceasefire, where you both have a dynamic where the powers seem to be on the verge of cooperation towards a new escalated war on terror to go after the Nusra Front and ISIS. On the other hand, they're angling for the best deal in the counter-revolutionary peace that they're all headed for in Syria. So there's competition and collaboration going on, which is characteristic of inter-imperial conflict in the whole history of capitalism.
And finally, Ashley, I'm just going to take you up on this issue of the chemical warfare. Now, there's been a lot of debate in the left among people as to whether there's evidence of chemicals used by Assad against his own people. What are your references here, and how do you know for sure?
Well, certainly there is fog of war in all these debates, but we have to remember these are dropped from the air, the vast bulk of the chemical weapons. They're being dropped from the air. There's only one real air force that's inside Syria, that is the Syrian regime itself. So they're the only ones with the technical capacity to drop the barrel bombs and drop the chemical weapons on the civilian population. Of course, there's the Russian air force that's there and the American air force, as well as its other coalition allies, quote-unquote coalition allies, are engaged in bombing runs, mainly targeting ISIS and the Nusra Front. But it's only really the Syrian air force that has the capacity and the interest to massacre the population with chemical weapons. The resistance, the revolutionaries, have no interest in gassing and killing their own people. These are attacks that have happened inside the areas where the Free Syrian Army and other rebel forces have been operating. They're not going to bomb their own popular support against the regime. So I think, you know, we can get into the technicalities of which many people have written and know the details inside and out. And I think have pretty conclusively proven that that the chemical warfare has been conducted by the Syrian regime and not the rebels or the resistance.
All right. Ashley, thank you so much for joining us today and look forward to having you back.
Thanks so much.
And thank you for joining us on The Real News Network.